I welcome all of them for this resident smart learning program. Today, the topic is small renal mass and techniques of nephron sparing surgery. We have Dr. Makarand Kaushikar, who is the chief uro-oncologist at the Siddhivinayak Ganapati Cancer Hospital in Meerut and a renowned uro-oncologic surgeon. And all of them are waiting for this important topic because it's important for the students, both for their practicals and for the theory. You will have a question in the theory about this. So I would now request Dr. Rajiv Sood to give his own. Dr. Rajiv Sood, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Keshav. This was another episode of our smart learning program. Dr. Makarand Kaushikar is with us. He's an eminent urologist and teacher. And the topic is also very important for resident point of view. As Dr. Keshav has already mentioned, small renal masses and nephron sparing surgery itself is a definite part of the examination, whether in the theory or in the viva or in any form, it will appear in the exams. So let us get into this interactive session. Our residents are ready to interact. The chat box is ready to get the questions, and Dr. Arun Chawla is ready to coordinate that. Once again, greetings from Indian School of Urology, and let us start. Back to Dr. Keshav.
So now I would invite Dr. Arun Chawla to introduce the speaker, and then we move on. Over to you, Arun.
Thank you, Dr. Keshav. Thank you, Dr. Keshav. And dear agents, it's indeed a privilege to introduce today's teacher, that is Makarand Kaushikar. Dr. Makarand Kaushikar is currently head of department at Siddhivinayak Cancer Hospital, Meerut, near Sangli, India. And actually, he is the first one to start a first ever exclusive uro-oncology department which is devoted to urological cancer treatment at Meerut. Very skilled surgeon, is very keen interest in academics and teaching. He is a recipient of many awards and honors. He has been bestowed Sri Lanka Urology Association Gold Medal, and he has been a recipient of a Urology Gold Medal from the Western section of USI. He's a proud recipient of Dr. Pinamani Venkateshwar Rao Endowment Lecture and Gold Medal from Urology Society of India, and has also received a Shearing Prize and Gold Medal from Institute of Urology, St. Peter Hospital, London, UK. He has been Indian National Delegate to Society of International Urology and is a consulting editor to BJUI International. Very active in zonal and USA academic program, and as well as the international forum. He has conducted and convened many programs in the area of uro-oncology at zones, the USICONS, and international conferences like SIU. With an area of interest in uro-oncology, he believes in comprehensive care of patients with urology cancers and has developed very nice innovations and modifications in the care of his patient, especially the patient with the urostomies, to improve their quality of life. A very articulate, and his presentations at any fora are thoroughly enjoyable with many carry-home messages. And today, we are going to have an academic feast with his talk on small renal mass and nephron-sparing surgery. I invite Dr. Makarand Kaushikar for today's class, and the stage is yours, sir. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Chawla. Am I audible?
Yes.
Right, okay. First of all, thank you everyone, Dr. Keshavamurthy, Dr. Sood, Dr. Chawla, Dr. Mallikarjun, the entire Indian School of Urology, Urological Society of India, and all the council members for inviting me to participate in small renal mass and nephron sparing surgery. Apologies for a few minutes delay for the technical hitch. So what I'm going to do is, the presentation is divided into two parts. The first part is going to be mainly on the small renal mass. And then subsequently, I'm going to, at the end of the presentation, I'm going to take you through the techniques of nephron sparing surgery, the different controversial issues as such, some case studies, and I'm sure the program warrants some degree of quiz and questions and answers, which Dr. Chawla is going to take us through. Now let us look at what the small renal mass is I'm going to talk about. We are going to tell you what definition of small renal mass, what does it mean, its evaluation, the natural history, the growth kinetics, whether we should biopsy these patients or not, these lesions, what are the treatment options. We talk about active surveillance, thermal ablation like cryo, high frequency needle ablation, HIFU. In terms of NSS, also we are going to touch upon enucleation, different techniques of partial nephrectomy, and what's the algorithm for a small renal mass. Now let us define small renal mass, which is called as an SRM. It's defined as a mass, a renal mass, which is less than 4 centimeters in size and clinically classified or staged as CT1A. What's the significance of this small renal mass? If it is less than 4 centimeters, CTA, then more than 20% chance that these patients would have a benign histopathology, maybe around 20%. There is a low chance of progression, the growth kinetics we are going to discuss in a short while. There is low chance of metastasis of these patients. And even if it's a malignant, 20%, less than 20% are of a very high grade. So we need to think and approach differently. So a lesion which is 20% chance of benign, even if it is malignant, only 20% are going to be high grade, low chance of spread and metastasis, then perhaps we can be less aggressive and focus on sort of whether we can treat this patient conservatively. That is the whole idea why we're talking about the small renal mass. Trainees, friends, and colleagues, you must be knowing this gentleman, Dr. Professor Michael Jewett from Toronto, Canada. This man has spent all his life in talking about active surveillance for renal cell carcinoma. Mike and myself have been associated for the last 20, 25 years. We have been part of World Urological Oncology Federation. He is also expert in testicular cancer, and a lot of publications you would see on small renal masses, active surveillance, you know, cystic renal masses, is all headed by Mike Jewett predominantly in the world literature. Like Laurie Claus from Canada, he talks about Gleason 6 and 6, active surveillance. Like similar, Mike Jewett is also from Canada and talks about it. So his tremendous contribution to small renal masses. So how do you evaluate small renal masses? Most of them would be seen and picked up on a routine ultrasound scan. When you evaluate these patients, when they had an ultrasound scan done, the CT scan is mandatory. You need to do a plane and contrast, except in patients who are pregnant, patients who have CKD, patients who have von Hippel-Lindau disease where renal failure is there or repeated, you don't want to do contrast CT, or sometimes you can do an MRI for a post-treatment follow-up. But predominantly, you need to do a CT scan. What it tells you, it tells you the Hounsfield value. It tells you about enhancement with the contrast, its cystic or solid, its location. Everything is told to us about by CT scan. It will also tell you single, multiple, unilateral, bilateral, and it gives a baseline information as far as imaging is concerned, because if you want to follow these patients in future for active surveillance or even by thermal ablation, you need to know the basic information, and that's why CT is important. They always do angiography 3D reconstruction. So in case if you are contemplating something like nephron sparing surgery, that comes handy. And as I mentioned earlier, if the patient is pregnant, patient has chronic renal failure, patient has von Hippel-Lindau disease, because you need to repeat these scans every now and then, you can do an MRI. And if you're treated these patients in a follow-up in CKD, you can always do these patients with an MRI itself. There is no role of PET scan. There is no doubt about it. A lot of people would say, is the role of PET scan in small renal mass? Perhaps not. You can do DMSA or DTPA renogram if you just want to estimate an eGFR. Nowadays, we are talking about molecular imaging. If you have a PET scan with a radio-level carbonic anhydrase, this is one marker which is used in renal cell carcinoma. It is still in an experimental phase. Carbonic anhydrase 9, monoclonal antibody, which can be tagged, it can provide specifically to tell you which are more aggressive tumors, including clear cell RCC and type 2 papillary RCC. So if at all, when I say there is no role of PET scan as of today, in future, we may have a molecular imaging with a PET scan, which is radiotable or tagged with carbonic anhydrase 9. There is also another SPECT CT, which is called as sestamibi-based PET CT or SPECT CT, and this can identify benign lesions or less aggressive variants of RCC, such as oncocytoma or hybrid oncocytic chromophobe renal tumors. So if you have these scans handy in future when time comes, perhaps you may not do biopsy in these patients, or you may treat conservatively in this group of patients. Now let us talk about natural history. And here I give a lot of credit to Mike Jewett and his team from Canada, because we have been told so far the natural history of untreated renal cell carcinoma, the growth rate is about 0.2 centimeter per year. This was when actually the evolution of understanding how the renal cell carcinoma grows. I always had this idea in my mind, all the renal cell carcinomas do not behave the same way. You have clear cell, you have papillary, you have so many other histologies. So would this growth rate would apply in general at the length and breadth of all varieties? The answer is perhaps no. Now, this is how this 0.28 centimeter per year, you know, this information came based on this sort of meta-analysis done in 2006. See, there were a lot of sort of, you know, work done here all around. And you will see the mean size was 2 centimeter, almost like less than 3 centimeter. They had a good follow-up, almost like on 34 months. And looking at different studies here, the value came here, 0.28 centimeter per year would be the growth kinetics for a renal cell carcinoma. That was the basis. Now look at this man who has a CT scan done. This was done way back. This is one sort of mass here. This is year 2 centimeter. This is year 2000. In August 2008, in 8 years' time, this has grown. I mean, this fellow for a lot of comorbidities, so many other illnesses, cardiac, diabetic, he never had any treatment done. And the size in 8 years went down to something like 8.5 centimeter. Now, a lot of people make a confusion that it should be something like 0.2 centimeter per year. This is the only rate at which all the tumors would grow. But you have to be very clear on this mind that 0.28 centimeter or 0.3 centimeter per year is sort of in a growth kinetics is probably applicable when the tumor reaches maximum size of 3 to 4 centimeter. Once it reaches 4 centimeter, the rule of growth kinetics doesn't apply. And from that onwards, 4 centimeter size, I think the tumors can grow rapidly and put, you know, exponentially thereafter. So this misunderstanding or this clear concept has to be there amongst the residents that once it reaches, this tumor has grown in 2008 with such a large amount, it goes to something like 3 to 4 centimeter, that growth kinetics rule or that sort of equation doesn't apply. This is what I mean. Now, the first time recently in about September 2020, we heard about this paper. And this was again by Mike Jewett and his associate, Anthony, Tony Finelli. He has a good amount of work as such. And a lot of people here in Canada here, you would see. Neil Fleischner is here, Simon Tongo is there. And all multinational study, it does suggest that it's not that only the size what we're looking at, but the histology is also important. It's a histology-specific growth rate. So they looked at 136 biopsy-prone renal cell carcinoma, small renal masses. They were managed by active surveillance, and they found that clear cell RCC small renal process grew much faster than papillary type 1. And this is how they said it would be something like 0.25 against 0.002. So papillary type 1, you know, grow very, very slowly as compared to clear cell RCC. That was the conclusion of the paper. So here you see papillary type 1, papillary type 2, chromophobe, RCC, and this is clear cell. So clear cell grows at 0.28 centimeter per year, while papillary 1 is almost something like a very, very slow growing as such. While you see here papillary type 2 and chromophobe, they grow in between. So it all depends on histology. So if the histology is papillary type 1, then I'm very convinced that this patient can be easier observed with active surveillance. Here, what 15% of clear cell RCC, they grow more than 0.5 centimeter per year. So this is how the histology based. You look at the histology and then try and find out some of them can be aggressive. And this is how you can decide whether these patients can be active surveillance or not. We talked about now histology. Now a lot of people are talking about doing something like genetic studies on the tissue biopsy. And then its implication towards the active surveillance itself. Now, in this study, they looked at VHL gene, MET, FLCN, BAP1, and these sort of genetic studies were done in small renal masses. So they had about 292 patients with 435 genetically defined tumors, and they found, if you have genetic studies done, the BAP1 deficient tumors has the fastest median growth. And this growth is varied between these different histologies or genetic, and this is what I said, the rapid growth of BAP1 deficient tumors, and this indicates that these patients cannot be treated conservatively, but should be treated aggressively. So here is a BAP1 deficient, VHL deficient, and here you see the growth rate. With a BAP1 deficient, the growth rate is 0.8 centimeter per year, VHL deficient 0.4 centimeter per year, If you have MIT activated, it is only about 0.13 centimeter per year, and it is 0.17 centimeter per year. This is FLCN deficient. So if you have genetic studies in due course of time, then we can understand which ones would grow, which ones would not grow, and then you can plan active surveillance versus the treatment itself. And this study actually is combining the histology on one side, as well as genetic sort of studies, and then tell us which one are going to be aggressive, which one are not going to be aggressive. And the same sort of in a figure, just to tell you that the BAP1 deficient, VHL deficient, are the ones sort of who grow faster than the rest of the histology and genetic variants. And this is another slide. Now, it is going to be in future the personalized treatment for small tumors. So you do something like genetic studies on tissue biopsy, you do something like histology, look at imaging, and then you can tailor the plan of treatment for these patients as such. Now, the next question comes here is whether we should biopsy these renal mass. It's like Shakespeare said, to be or not to be. And the answer is yes, you need to have a biopsy. In the past, we always believed that CT is almost always diagnostic of benign or malignant lesion. You have enhancement, you see the size, you see the Hounsfield values, and then you say most probably it is renal cell carcinoma. But if you want to plan an active surveillance, it is important that you need to have biopsy. Even if you want to plan a treatment, it is better to have a biopsy. Another reason I told you, once you know the histology, once you know the genetic studies, you can decide which way to go. How to do a biopsy, ultrasound or CT guided? Three cores are minimum. Central one is important, and you can take two lesions, two set of biopsies from the periphery. FNAC usually does not help, and you really require expert pathologists, and also there is an issue of negative biopsy. Look at the sensitivity. This has just come last week from AUA guidelines, and it does suggest that the sensitivity and specificity of renal masses is absolutely good, so you should be doing renal mass biopsy. Now, people talk about risk of seedling, bleeding, AV fistulas, and then sort of, difficulties for the pathologist in the final specimen, margins when you do nephron-sparing surgery, what do you do when it is negative or false negative results? And then sometimes oncocytoma can be associated with renal cell carcinoma, but these are a few things which are actually sort of coming along with renal biopsy, but you can negate those by after proper counseling. Now see what has happened. A very badly done biopsy. You see large hematoma, the patient was taken for a nephron-sparing surgery. It was a lower polar renal mass, a large hematoma. And when you actually go inside, you can't really make it out whether there is enough margin. Once you try and open the Gerardus fascia after clamping the kidney, you can't really know how it is going to happen. So sometimes you really have to go in, sort of do a sort of a total nephrectomy or radical nephrectomy, and the patient had a few skip lesions in the other kidney as well. Now you see one biopsy done in the center itself. We have gone in after 3 weeks, good clear margins. So the biopsy, how you do it, is also extremely important. Once you have biopsy, then what next? I think this table, all the trainees, if you remember, I think is going to be much more helpful and handy for you in dealing with small renal masses. So you've done the renal mass biopsy, you can do molecular profile or genetic profile. If it turns benign, 20% chance, just an active surveillance. If it shows indolent cancer, meaning it's a low-grade disease, it's a papillary type 1, chromophobe, oncocytic, then you can think of active surveillance, or you can do thermal ablation, which means either you can do cryo or you can do radio frequency needle ablation. If at all you really want to plan or patient is not keen, you can do partial nephrectomy. But the biopsy shows potentially aggressive disease, then either you can do a partial or radical nephrectomy, depending on the location. You get something renal sinus tumor, renal hyalur tumor, a 2 centimeter lesion. I don't think you can do a partial in this case, and you can opt for a partial nephrectomy. So this is how post biopsy treatment algorithm should be. Now we talk about active surveillance. What is active surveillance? It is not just wait and watch like any other neurological malignancies. You need to be monitoring these patients very, very closely. We need to follow them with ultrasound and CT, look for symptoms, and you do intervention if there is significant increase in the size, symptoms, or unwillingness to continue for active surveillance. And in that situation, you should also counsel patients. If at all you need be, patients may require a repeat biopsy. Now, active surveillance, you should do in patients who have favorable or non-aggressive histology. Elderly patients with short life expectancy, patients who have CKD, patients not keen for surgical or focal treatment, hereditary renal cell carcinoma with lesions less than 3 centimeter, except syndromes with aggressive histology and behavior. It is not suitable, or it is not sort of, you know, advisable in patients who are young, fit, who have long life expectancy, and they really do not want to take risk of repeated imaging of radiation and other things. And those who are obviously non-compliant for imaging, these patients are not suitable for our active surveillance. Now, this is again come in a new AUA guidelines 2021, how you frequently do the active surveillance and what do the imaging as such is perhaps every 3 to 6 months, use cross-sectional imaging and ultrasound as well. And then subsequently, if you want to do active surveillance, approximately every 6 months, and use ultrasound if it is expected management compared to active surveillance. Here you can sort of increase the duration here. And the potential triggers when you intervene, tumor size grows more than 3 centimeters, stretch progression, growth kinetics grows much higher, clinical change in the patients and tumor factors, and additional biopsy results, then perhaps you need to treat these patients. Look at worldwide studies here. Here you have sort of, you know, Savary. You would have here something, you know, coming from Wolf. He also from a good sort of chap who come from Europe. Then Wasim Kassab. And all these sort of, you know, studies just suggest that active surveillance is pretty safe and you can actually practice in your day-to-day practice. Now, the second option in these patients is thermal ablation. Thermal ablation, which includes something like, you know, cryo or radio frequency needle ablation, and it has come as an alternative to nephron sparing surgery in small renal masses. The long-term efficacy of thermal ablation is not yet established, but available data does suggest that local recurrence may be slightly higher than those reported with partial or radical nephrectomy. So how do you do thermal ablation? Patients with advanced age, patients with significant comorbidities, patients with local recurrence after previous nephron sparing surgery, that's another indication, and those with multifocal tumors. Now, in cryoablation, the cryoablation, it does mean that you can do either, you know, percutaneously, you can do laparoscopically, you can do open. And what is important here is basically you are going to use sort of needles, you are going to cool the kidneys, desiccate the whole tissue, and the necrosis takes place. And the temperature within the tumor has to be something like 40 degrees centigrade. Now, this is a kidney here, and the renal tumor sort of necrosis would be achieved when we can reach minus 40 degree temperature, and the normal renal tissue temperature during the procedure would be about 19 degrees centigrade. What you do is a slow thaw, which is important for recrystallization process, because the intracellular ice crystal continues to expand. The repeated cycle improves the odds of complete eradication of the tumor. And once the cryoablation is complete, reperfusion of the damaged microcirculation leads to microthrombi formation, microcirculatory occlusion, and results into ischemia and destruction. So as I said, you can do laparoscopically, transperitoneal or retroperitoneal, basically for the posterior tumors. Now, this is how it has been done. You do intraoperative ultrasound. Now, these multiple percutaneous needles are actually sort of put inside here. These are the needles which are put inside. They are called as a cryo probes after the biopsy. And after that, what you do is actually first freeze thaw. You know, first freeze thaw cycle begins. It continues till the ice ball is formed. And once it extends beyond a particular size, something like about a centimeter or two, then you sort of stop. Then the ice ball is allowed to thaw prior to installation of the second freeze thaw. So you do something like 2 sessions, allow it complete to thaw, and this is how the cryo ablation is done. So as I said, you can do percutaneously also, but you can do something like open laparoscopy, retroperitoneoscopic, robotic, you can do it. Now, what is the difference between laparoscopy or minimally invasive and percutaneous one? The invasive is much more obviously when you actually go inside. Here is less invasive, you can do under local anesthesia. Percutaneously, it's a bit complex. You can't do multifocal tumors. There is no direct control on this. The local tumor recurrence is higher in percutaneous, but it's much more easier to do it. It's more difficult to do it, retreatment, especially if you look at cryoablation. Now, as I said to you, you need to regularly follow these patients. There is a chance that these patients may recur or fail locally. The 5-10 year survival rate in these patients is in the range of something like 78 to 80%, which is not bad. Now, second thermal ablation, what we talk about is radio frequency needle ablation. And this is attractive. Here, the temperature which is used to get the necrosis is about 105 degrees. You know, it can reach up to 105, but the tissue destroyed the temperature exceeding 70 degrees centigrade. So, if you reach 70 degrees centigrade, it will leave behind the necrotic lesion after 24 to 48 hours and reaching the maximum size in about 7 days. The disadvantage is it's very difficult to monitor in real time, as there is no true ice ball equivalent to what you do in cryo as such. So that is the difference between cryo and needle ablation. So you do a laparoscopic radio frequency needle ablation percutaneous. MRI is currently best. You can still sort of do under CT guided. And this is done percutaneously, needle ablation here, like what you do for a liver metastasis. This is pre-ablation here, 3 months post, and this is 12 months post-ablation. Now, in terms of local recurrence rate, is in the range of something like 88% to 92%, which is not too bad. The AUA guidelines examined almost 10 studies of cryo and radio frequency needle ablation, 10 studies each, and they found that the recurrence-free survival rate of something like 90%, which is not too bad. And these are few studies to substantiate that the completion of ablation and the recurrence-free rate in thermal ablation. So overall survival rate is not too bad, and Dronovic has also done a good amount of work, and there does not appear to be any significant difference in overall survival between cryo and thermal ablation. And this is how you have local recurrence rate between partial nephrectomy versus primary tumor thermal ablation. And it favors partial nephrectomy because there is a less chance of recurrence as compared to thermal ablation. But remember, you can always go back and do a partial nephrectomy in these patients. Similarly, if these patients fail partial nephrectomy, you can always do a thermal ablation. And this is how it says in AUA guidelines. Now, this is typically a guy, we as in Cambridge, we used to do a lot of berry picking of von Hippel-Lindau disease. And these patients can be suitable nowadays for radio frequency needle ablation or cryo. Now, a few things are coming up. You have HIFU, laser interstitial thermal therapy, irreversible evaporation. You can do embolization and ablation or microwave ablation. And this is how HIFU, this is how HIFU device, and this is how you can do with the Stokes HIFU device. It's the mechanical arm. And you can see the result before HIFU and 12 months post HIFU itself. But still experimental. This RCC was a remote partial nephrectomy was done after HIFU, showing a lot of necrosis. So a lot of work is going on HIFU itself. This is quite interesting. Now, EAU 2021 now mentions the ablative external radiotherapy as one of the alternative to thermal ablation. Quite interesting, isn't it? And we never thought about using radiotherapy for renal cell carcinoma. And now they're talking about using for CTA and CT1B. But again, the early results show it can sort of, you know, help us, but you require randomized controlled trials. So a small renal mass, you can do active surveillance or thermal ablation. And if not, if you don't want to do this, you can always do enucleation, partial nephrectomy, and in difficult situations, you can do a radical nephrectomy. So at the end of my first talk, I'm going to give an algorithm here. So when do you do sort of, you know, active surveillance here? Active surveillance is done in patients who are older, severe renal dysfunction, hereditary RCC with a neoplasm of less than 3 cm, and less aggressive tumors. But patients is non-compliant, young patients, you do not do it. Focal ablation, small peripheral lesion. Patients who is a poor surgical candidate, but you do not do thermal ablation. The patient who is young, patient who have a hilar mass going to collecting system and a larger renal mass. Now, if you have a partial nephrectomy for a solitary kidney, pre-existing CKD, bilateral tumors, you can do a partial here. But if patient has coagulopathy, complex anatomy, you may not be able to do that. So this is how the algorithm is. So mass less than 4 cm, percutaneous biopsy, you do histology genetic studies, and then you choose according to, as I said, the indications, either active surveillance, focal ablation, partial or radical nephrectomy itself. And this is the end, again, coming back to the same slide, which is the take home message, that if you have something like indolent lesion, try active surveillance or thermal ablation. If not, you can go for a partial nephrectomy. So I'm going to take a break here. We have Dr. Chawla, Dr. Keshamurthy. I can see Amit goes also here. And if there are any questions to break the monotony, I'll take a few questions or interaction. I'll then sort of stop share, go back to my other presentation. I can answer your questions. Is that okay?
Yeah, we'll finish everything and then we'll have a question answer session. Yeah.
Okay, fine. So let me go now for my second talk. Are you able to see my screen now?
Not yet. It is started, but we are not seeing it.
Is it okay? No? Not yet?
Not yet. Not yet.
I think I resume share. Okay, I don't know. It's been paused. Okay. Am I there?
Full screen. You have to make full screen.
Yeah, I will. But you are able to see now?
Yeah, yeah. We are able to
yeah.
see.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Fine. So this is the part two is going to be a nephron sparing surgery. Greetings from my hospital. So indications for nephron sparing surgery: small renal mass, tumor in the solitary kidney. As we all know about, the size location is important. Tumors in CKD, diabetic, hypertensive, bilateral tumors, and one equal in our disease. What is important, there is no substitute for the good preoperative planning and stepwise execution of the surgery. So what do you mean by preoperative planning? As I mentioned to you in my first part of the talk, you need a 3D CT scan with contrast. Information is very, very important. Single vessel, double vessel, feeding vessel, extremely important. And you should get a 3D view of this. You need to do renal function tests. It's always important you get the eGFR. Consider comorbidities and ASS score is extremely important. Now, I told you why this 3D CT is going to be important with angio pictures. Because many times in a tertiary center, we get one sort of standard sort of CT scan, and we really don't know what the vessels are like, what the feeder vessels are like. And that's why this is a wonderful 3D reconstruction of a bilateral renal masses. Here you see the information I have. You have a right renal artery. It has two feeders here. You have, this is a large tumor on the left-hand side. And perhaps I may be able to occlude this and take a sort of a partial on other side. Here also, you take sort of subtracting images. This is an upper polar tumor on the right side. So you need to have a 3D pictures here. Let me go back. And this is another picture, right lower polar renal mass. And I know I'm not going to clamp the entire thing. I can do selective clamping here and do this something like, Bosniak 3 lesion, what he had turned out to be cystic RCC. So there is no substitute for good angio pictures. We all should have a basic idea what this CKD by GFR and albuminuria category according to KDGO, because this is very, very important. What's the low risk? What's the moderate risk and high risk? Keep this table in your office. Label these patients what kind of GFR they have and the risk they have, because when they come back for a follow-up, we need to know what the basic eGFR was. Apart from this preoperative imaging, there is a lot of talk about renal morphometry score. And we talk about renal score, Padua score, SPARE, C-index. But I think what is important for us day-to-day practice is renal and Padua. And I'm going to touch upon a few sort of interesting sort of scores as well here. Now here you see, this is the renal score. In the renal score, what it does mean is R is radius, E is exophytic or endophytic, N is nearness of the tumor to the collecting system, A is anterior or posterior, and then L is location related to the polar line. This is a polar line. This is a polar line. And then it will tell you that N is, or H is assigned if the tumor touches the main renal artery on a vein when it says H. So here you would see patients who have sort of a radius, whatever diameter less than 4 centimeter and all around over here, exophytic, endophytic, nearness to the PC system. And then you will get the points here. At the end of the day, you put all this information together and then you calculate the renal score. And this was done basically first time by Robert Uzo. Now, this is Padua score. What does Padua score mean? It does tell you about the preoperative aspects and dimensions used for anatomical classification. And I'll tell you in details what this Padua score is all about. And this was first published in 2009. By Ficarra. Now, when Ficarra actually published his paper, he told us about the different locations of these kind of tumors. He also told you about the what is anterior phase, what is the posterior phase, and then classified these tumors according to its location and its sort of presence in the kidney itself. Now, what is the difference between PADU1 and renal score? It's usually a polar line which is used in renal score, while in PADU1, it is a sinus line. The sinus lines on the CT and MRI by appearance of this sort of adipose tissue and hypodense tissue inside the renal parenchyma. And the renal sinus involvement is taken as a separate renal parameter. Now, we are talking about in 2020, another sort of system, which is called as a simplified PADU1 renal, which is called as combination of these both, PADU1 renal spares nephrometry system in predicting the surgical outcomes. Why you want to do it? Because you want to know how technically you can go in. What are the chances that you may not be able to do a partial nephrectomy? What are the technical challenges you will see? And that is how it's important you get the renal morphometry score. And now this is what it is. You will see this is a maximum tumor size, exophytic rate. You will see renal sinus involvement, what's the score it has been given, and the rim location. So this is a spare system. It's based on tumor size, tumor deepening into the parenchyma, relationship with renal sinus, margin location. And this is how you can calculate this spare score. And how do you correlate this spare score, renal score, and PADU1 score? This is how, you know, different scores are here, and it will tell you how much ischemia time you will require, how much operative time you will require, what would be the estimated blood loss. So this is to prepare you to get into action mode before you do a surgery. There is another score which has come as zonal nephro score, which is another Japanese score, again came in 2020 here. And this is quite interesting. It tells you about nearness to the PC system, physical zones, radius, and organization. And it's just to predict the intraoperative as well as the post-op outcomes. There is another score which is called the DAP score, just for an academic interest. I don't think we use these kind of scores in a day-to-day practice. Just to complete the list of different scores, there is also called the C-centrality index. And this is just to tell you, the middle plane is identified using the image section and a number showing the upper and lower kidney borders itself. And then you calculate the C-index. But again, it's more of a theoretical. And another score which has come is the arterial base complexity score. Just as the residents, you should know about it. But in real practice, what we use, the renal and PADU, at the most, you can combine spare score to identify, you know, which are the patients who are going to get difficulty during partial nephrectomy. For me, rather than score, I put this sort of picture for you for a better understanding. So I do a sort of dramatic, you know, sort of now sketch picture in my indoor file or operative files, and just sort of say where the tumor location is, how I'm going to plan the nephron sparing surgery. It's much more easier. So what is important, you want to know where is the upper pole or lower pole and a mid pole. Polar lesions, no problem at all. You can counsel the patients and say, yes, I'm going to definitely do a partial nephrectomy. The mid polar one can be very, very tricky in terms of repair. Second thing which I want to know, whether it is an exophytic or is an endophytic. So forget about all the scores as such and giving values and everything. But this is how you should look at the CT scan, draw a picture in your sort of operation notes or clinical notes, and then think about it. If you have an endophytic tumor, you should be prepared to do nephron sparing surgery. Maybe it needs skeletal repair. Maybe I might do retrograde pyelogram, put a catheter, use methylene blue, put a stent in for these kind of tumors. If it is invading the renal sinus, coming from mid-pole and mainly, partly is going to be endophytic, then I'm going to sort of think about repair. Repair is going to be challenging. And if it is going to be something endophytic, renal sinus, high chance the patient would have need a radical nephrectomy. And this is how the importance of planning your treatment with the angio, nephrometry score, and the location of the tumor. Now, as I told you, this patient had a tumor in the renal sinus. No way you can do nephron sparing surgery, which you can predict by preoperative CT scan. Another guy, which is only about 2 centimeter lesion in the renal sinus. I couldn't do any enucleation. There was infiltration. Turned out to be tubulocystic type of RCC, and you had to spare the entire kidney for this renal sinus tumor. Other challenge when you look at the CT scan is the posterior tumors, especially when you are doing laparoscopy, especially when you're doing a robotic surgery. For open, it's okay. You can clip the kidney, but if it is something lap or robotic, the posterior location, 3D reconstruction, images on the CT scan, you should think about when you plan partial nephrectomy. Giving an example, look at this tumor. It's a posterior-based tumor. So I may think twice before I actually plan a partial nephrectomy laparoscopic. Sometimes what appears on a CT scan, what actually seen inside is different. This man had, you know, von Hippel-Lindau disease. Lot of cystic areas, and I thought the solid areas we can do a partial. But when I went inside, these are all cystic areas and solid areas. When I went inside, you see multiple solid areas. So when I counsel this patient preoperatively, I'm not going to promise him something like thermal aberration or something like a partial nephrectomy. Be prepared for this guy for a radical nephrectomy, because what you see on a CT scan, despite all those scores, this can be entirely different. Now, counseling is extremely important. You tell patients why you want to do nephron-splitting surgery. Because a lot of times, patients and relatives come and say, see, doc, it's a cancer. We don't want partial nephrectomy. 10 years ago, AUA did a survey, and they found that a lot of patients wanted to be a laparoscopic surgery. A lot of doctors were pushing for a laparoscopic radical nephrectomy because they say, you may need an open surgery to do a partial nephrectomy. But now things have changed. Now people have understood you can preserve the nephrons, you can preserve the kidney. But that sort of an fear is always in the mind of patients, relatives, and say, why you want to do nephron surgery? You should be able to justify the reasons behind it. Tell them the procedure involved. Tell them about you're going to do a frozen section and a margin issue. If the margins are positive, you might revise it or may think of doing radical nephrectomy or partial possible nephrectomy. And also tell them about the complications. Because with all the new technologies, we are seeing more and more patients with collections, AV fistulas, bleeding. So that helps also to be told. Now, technique-wise, nephron-sparing surgery, we do either partial, wedge excision, or enucleation. You can use hypothermia, or you can do without hypothermia. Now, cooling of the kidney is always preferred. Because if it is a big tumor, then you can take your own sweet time to repair the PC system, renal parenchyma. It's not that I'm suggesting each and every patient should get sort of hypothermia, but the tertiary center what we face is something like a bigger tumors, complex tumor, bilateral tumors, and I take my own sweet time to clamp the vessel, ice the kidney, cool the kidney, and then do nephron-sparing surgery. You need a very good vascular control. You should know the art of pelvic adhesion parenchymal repair. I'll explain what it means, and you need a good surgical skills and experience. And it's important you get a frozen section. Unless you take the tumor, you bivalvate, and you see a grossly good renal parenchyma, you don't waste time for a waiting for a frozen section. You start repairing the PC system and the renal parenchyma. And what is important is use intraoperative ultrasound scan for margins, location, especially for an endophytic tumor. If you have an exophytic tumor, you probably may not need it except for the margins. But if you have true endophytic tumor, keep this sort of a tool handy and get the radiologist on the board itself. I'm sure this may work, may not work, but if it doesn't, then it's fine. You're not able to see it? Are you able to see?
No, Makran, we are not able to see.
Fine. So I'll go and then show the video clip at the end of my presentation. Now, this is, as I said to you, this is a right renal artery, a left renal artery. I showed you this case before, and you need to sort of see which vessel you want to clamp. Selectively, you want to clamp, use hypothermia or no hypothermia. Now, this guy, I'll go back to the slide here. He came to me almost 16 years ago. He had a large tumor on the left-hand side, which turned out to be oncocytoma, and this was renal cell carcinoma, biopsy proven. So in the first stage, I did sort of a left partial nephrectomy. You can see this is post-partial left nephrectomy, and the tumor on the right side is still there. It was clear cell sort of an RCC, sorry, not oncocytoma. The margins were clear, Furman grade 2. Now, post left nephron sparing surgery, this was a CT here. The tumor on the right side is still persistent here. And this is what I mean. It may turn out to be something like an exophytic, but tumor still have its roots in the parenchyma. And you have sort of isolated vessel. This is all open, done almost 16 years ago. Renal artery, renal vein has been looped here. That's the IVC. And this is how the renal capsule, or sort of gerudal fasciae, has been opened. And this has been sort of identified. Then here I use intraoperative ultrasound for looking at the margins, looking at the margins itself. And you see how beautifully the tumor has been taken out. You see a clear margins, completely removed. This also turned out to be clear cell RCC, grade 2. Is disease free for 16 years. Just last week, we did a sort of a scan again. And this is how partial done on the left-hand side. And this is sort of repair on the right side. Even you won't be able to make it out, sort of what it is all about. It's 16 years post-op, creatinine is 1.5, left 5 centimeter, right 3 centimeter. So proper planning, proper execution is extremely important. Obviously, those who are very good in skills can always do a laparoscopy, but it's a very highly skilled operation. You go inside transperitoneally or retroperitoneally. You can use intraoperative ultrasound, isolate the vessels, put the sort of Satansky around sort of renal artery, keep the renal vein free here, and then actually sort of, you know, use all your scissors and go inside, have adequate margins, look at your base, whether you are going to the tumor or capsule, and slowly peel it up. And then you do the PC system repair. You can use sort of, you know, electrocardia, argon beam laser here, put a surgical, and this is how you repair. There are many ways of doing renography, which I'm going to touch in a short course of time. Now, there are a lot of important issues. What is about cancer cure? A lot of people talked about the cancer cure, partial versus radical, but now this procedure has been established for such a long time, I don't think there is going to be debate now. You have sort of here nephron sparing surgery on one side, radical nephrectomy, 5-year survival rate, if you look at, almost equivalent as compared to radical nephrectomy. And this was a long time back. I used to use this study or slide in the past, and this is wonderful. Now, so many years passed by. Now we know it has come a standard care. Has it percolated all over the globe? I think unfortunately not. Still a lot of people do not sort of go for nephron sparing surgery, and eventually it will keep on growing in due course of time. Now talking about renography, I'll tell you reopen technique, the lap robotic technique, what the issue of post-op artifact, the delayed bleeding issue, and AV malformations. What is important in open is once you sort of take either sort of take a clean cut or age or whatever it is, age or whatever it is, you look at the PC system. You repair it with 50 PDS. You underrun the vessels around it. What usually I do, I run sort of a continuous suture along the parenchyma along with sort of the entire rim, and then do the approximating sutures. And I use something like 40 PDS, which is a very small needle, very good tensile strength, and you really do not damage too much of the nephrons. I usually don't like to use sort of clips because they can create artifacts in the post-op CT and they can migrate. Use interrupted closure for the parenchyma, continuous for the PC system. You can always use a collagen patch. You can use continuous suturing. It reduces the warm ischemia time, or you can do a sliding slit, reduces the warm ischemia time. Now, there are two ways of doing it, renography here. Either you pass through and through here, and then slice it along with the clip, it comes close to each other, or you can do circumferential. But I think the whole idea is try and reduce the renal parenchymal damage as much as you can. So one is transitional transmission of force. This is perpetual transmission of force, sliding clip technique. This is over the top suturing technique. So whatever it is, be very careful and try not to sort of damage remaining nephrons. That is very important. The next question comes is whether you should clamp or you should not clamp. It's again another big question, is like to do a biopsy or not to do a biopsy. If you clamp, there is a less blood loss. There is a good visualization of the margin and the depth because you see so beautifully, especially in the big bulky patients, patients who have a lot of perimetric fat, the bigger tumors, you don't see much. And here actually sort of need a good visualization to have proper repair. You can do a good repair. People talk about ischemic injury, which I'm going to take you in details in next few slides. If you don't use clamp for the fear of this, you can have more blood loss. There'll be poor visualization of the PC system. You may not have the correct margins and depth of due to bleeding, but people say there is no ischemic injury. But at the end of the day, if you're not able to see properly, it keeps on bleeding and you keep on sort of putting big sutures, lap, robotic, or open whatever surgery, then what's better? I think you have to have a proper balance as such. Now, ischemia time, cold ischemia, we talk about is about 60 minutes, 40 minutes you can use it. Warm ischemia, about 30 minutes. Let us get it to root of it. What is the standard? What is the reality? What is the hypothesis? And do we really have a correct evidence about the ischemia time history or ischemia time, whatever hypothesis we have, a story of ischemia in our lifetime? What happens in ischemia? You get ATP depletion, and that's why the injury takes place. And if you clamp, declamp, and again clamp, reperfusion injuries can be more dangerous, superoxide generation, and then you can get reperfusion injuries. Now we look at the first paper. which was first published by Watt in 1975 in the British Journal of Urology. And this paper was based on a canine studies, and they did tell us about the optimum temperature for regional hypothermia. In this paper, there was no mention about the time used for ischemia. Use 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 60 minutes, what damage it can do to the nephrons. And if you look at Andrew Novick's work, with all due respect, Andrew Novick published huge amount of work on nephrons during surgery and ischemia time. In his publication first, which came in 1983, renal hypothermia, he did a lot of laboratory work. And then based on that, you get this table. 10 minutes with warm ischemia time, the recovery of renal function is within minutes. 20 minutes, you get recovery within hours. 30 minutes, you get recovery in 3 to 9 days. 60 minutes, complete recovery within weeks. And 120 minutes, incomplete recovery. And this publication, Andrew Novick's paper, if you try and go back again and try and find out original Watt's paper, there is no mention where these figures came from. 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. And blindly, we are following up these kind of minutes, you know, to use as sort of a scale where we can use time as an important factor to decide whether it is safe or unsafe for the kidney. So what we have been practicing in the past, after all that sort of studies and everything, we first said about 30 minutes warm ischemia time should be okay, right? Then people said 14 minutes is okay. Few papers came in almost like 90s and 2000. Then when the laparoscopy, robotics started coming, laparoscopy came, Indy Gill came with a lot of information and papers, a lot of European guys also came. They said every minute counts. It's not only sort of, you know, 14 minutes. Then we talked about you can clamp, but you start doing early declamping. Then came, you start without any clamping. You excise the tumor. If it's not much bleeding, that's okay. And then you clamp when it's required. Then subsequently, Indy Gill came with a technique which is called as a no clamp technique, which is called a zero ischemia. So this was the evolution. You have first paper in 1975 by Watt, did the work on Andrew Novick, and subsequently now people are talking about ischemia time, almost like it doesn't matter, and then zero ischemia people are talking about. These are all no hypothermia techniques, which I'm going to show you. This was good old days in Cambridge. You actually do not clamp the vessels. You actually hold the parenchyma. Just you can hold it with the hand, or a pressure, manual pressure, is something like an manipulation. You take the tumor out and repair it, something like this. Good old technique. You're not actually clamping the renal vessels. Now, guy like this, we used to have a big center of Vene von Eppel Lindau in Cambridge, and here you see multifocal disease here. And here we used to go and do it without clamping the vessels, no hypothermia, no warm ischemia. And this was something like manipulation for von Eppel Lindau disease. At this point, I would like to make very clear, what is the difference between the enucleation and a partial nephrectomy? Enucleation, you don't take parenchyma along with this. You just go around the closed sort of renal capsule without breaking it and take it out. This is good for adenomas, low-grade RCCs, exophytic peripheral tumors. That's okay. Maybe tumor sitting in the renal hilum. You really sort of don't go inside an enucleated tumors. But when you do a partial nephrectomy, you take good amount of renal parenchyma, at least 0.2 or 0.1 centimeter, and this is important. People say if you just have a sort of one cell line here is okay. So that's the difference between enucleation and partial nephrectomy. Now, clamp versus no clamp. There were a lot of papers which came, and this was from John Libertino, a big name in urological oncology. Non-clamp partial nephrectomy, techniques and surgical outcomes. So this is how he did it. Did not clamp, we actually went inside. This is a tumor here, almost between renal sinus here. So you dissect the whole renal sinus artery way in the bed, and only the feeding vessel has been ligated there, and the tumor has been taken out. You can see the entire vessels here in the renal sinus. Now, this case is mine, a guy who was 75, diabetic, hypertensive, critical ischemic heart disease. He had left PCNL done. Now he presented with the hematuria, and this was a mass here. You can see he's sitting almost like a renal sinus here. Enhancement on the contrast here. Now, cool the kidney here. This patient, actually, we clamped the vessel. We clamped the vessel because I was not very sure we can actually go into the renal sinus without clamping the vessels. And this clamping actually would help me. Then take the tumor out. You can see the vessels here. And this was not primarily repaired. this renal sinus tumor in a solitary kidney was not repaired, cortical repair wasn't done. It was just left at peace, just with the parenchymal sutures, and just surgicellular surgiform was kept, and you can see the reperfusion very well. Now, hilar clamping, non-hilar clamping, which is partial tumors in a solitary kidney. And what it suggests that non-clamping patients versus hilar clamping, you know, it says complete hilum is being clamped. Here you see the GFR preoperatively, early and late. Patients who did not have clamping had a better GFR as compared to the patients who did have a clamp. And this was the same study saying that the clampless sort of partial nephrectomy may be much better than using the clamp. And this is how Indy Girls work. Initially, when he started working, he started using something like a hypothermia, hypotensive anesthesia. And then selectively segmental artery was picked up. He used to use 3D pictures, you know, and then used to selectively clamp the artery to do a partial nephrectomy. And this was his technique. Laparoscopy, intraoperative ultrasound has been done in the endophytic tumor. Renal vessels are isolated. This is renal artery here. Then he started dissecting it out, and the tumor is after locating by intraoperative ultrasound. This is intraoperative ultrasound, and he used sort of small clip here for a selective clamping here, and he's continuously monitoring on ultrasound scan. While monitoring on ultrasound scan, selectively the vessel has been clipped here. Rest of the circulation in the kidney is very well maintained, and slowly, step by step, once you have demarcated the tumor, he has gone all around. Took the tumor out. While taking the tumor out, look at the base here, that you are not going into the capsule or renal sinus itself. And then subsequently, PC has been repaired. Use sort of a clips, hemologs, only single vessel has been clamped. And then subsequently do a complete repair here by the sliding technique. So only single selective vessel has been clamped, rest perfusion has been completely sort of done. And this is at the end of the day with a sliding technique. So this was zero ischemia technique. And you can always use something like these fancy images using sort of, you know, hyperspectral imaging cameras to see the circulation during surgery. Till then, it was okay. But I'm sure you must have heard about Dr. Deepen Parekh, a urologist, you know, originated from India. Now, sort of, you know, he's doing good amount of work in Miami. He came out way back in 2011 with challenging this sort of, you know, hypothesis of 30 minutes, 60 minutes ischemia time. So what he did was all open nephron-sparing surgery without sort of, you know, clamping, with or without clamping, with or without hypothermia. So what he did was, this was first presented in EUA 2011, the late breaking news. After exploration, when the patients actually were clamped or not clamped, he did a biopsy before he started, right, of the normal renal parenchyma. He kept on doing the partial nephrectomy. And every 10 minutes and 5 to 10 minutes after declamping, he took a biopsy from the remaining renal parenchyma. Quite a novel idea. He also looked at biomarkers and enzymes and GFR and creatinine clearance in these patients. All those tissues were looked under electron microscopy, light microscopy and fluorescence. Looked at the average warm ischemia time was 23 minutes. Average cold ischemia time was 48 minutes. Almost 80% less than 30 minutes. And he found there was no significant renal damage with ischemia time, either it's warm or cold, between 30 to 60 minutes. So now you see where we stand now. We started with something like, you know, less than 30 minutes, 14 minutes, every minute counts, zero ischemia, selective clamping. And now this guy comes and tells us, with all due respect and all the hard work what he has done, and I'm really sort of happy he did this work, that he said there is no significant renal damage with ischemia time of 30 to 60 minutes. However, this has been challenged by many people. This is how we did. Basically, 2 to 3 sort of a biopsies, pre-nephron sparing surgery, one biopsy every 10 minutes, and 1 to 2 biopsies after declamping, and his sort of repair has been going on at the same time. So it has come to a full circle. He started with something like, you know, 60 minutes, then 30 minutes, 14 minutes, every minute count, zero ischemia, again back to 60 minutes. It's quite interesting. So what is important is do your job very properly. Do not do clamp, unclamp. The outcome is pretty good if you do a meticulous job. There is no substitute for a clean or good job. And people keep on talking, even with, I did debate with Dr. Chawla, I think recently, whether we should do open versus minimal invasive surgery. And this is how my views is. Do a good job, whether it's lab, robotic, open, you need to repair, you need to do a good sort of parenchymal repair, PC system repair, have clear margins, and do this job as meticulously as possible. Now, conclusions of lab versus open, comparative oncological safety. You may have increased warm ischemia time with laparoscopy or robotic. It's technically demanding, but should be done minimally invasive surgery with people with experience as such. Complex renal masses, I always feel that I think the open surgery is better, safer, effective, good outcome, and a preferred choice. What is the aim of nephron sparing surgery? We're talking about open versus minimal invasive. Preserve the nephrons, preserve the renal function, no violation of oncological principles. You want to cure as well as care and avoid immediate and long-term complications of a radical nephrectomy. Which technique fulfills this, open or nephron sparing? Let us look at what the open does. Preserving nephrons, you make a clean cut in open. You don't use diathermy or sort of any other energy. You can do meticulous repair of the PC system. And this is how it's been done. Unfortunately, the video did not work. And this is how clear margins you get. You do a good repair, job done in 20 minutes time. Minimally invasive surgery, can you do a clean cut? Think about it. Use sort of physical energy. Meticulous repair, you see and show the repair what has been done and what point I'm trying to drive here. Now, after doing partial, see the amount of nephropexy what you're doing or renorrhaphy what you're doing. The amount of renal parenchyma which comes after compressing the about 1 to 2 centimeter renal parenchyma with sliding technique, whatever it is, you are damaging fair amount of nephrons. Ischemia time is a key factor. Functional time, renal mass is also important. So what point I'm driving here is not only the ischemia time, the amount of renal parenchyma you leave behind is also extremely important. Warm ischemia time, what we talked about, minimal ischemia is important. Hypothermia cold ischemia is better for complex tumor. Now, is it possible to achieve the hypothermia in laparoscopy robotics? I'm not sure. Now, this is a new concept. This is done again, propagated by Steve Campbell, a very respectful name in urological oncology. He kept on pushing this, saying that ischemia time is not important in partial nephrectomy. What is important is the amount of healthy renal parenchyma you leave behind. This is devascularized parenchymal mass, which is after partial nephrectomy. And if it is more, then you are going to leave a large amount of tissue, which is necrotic and devascularized. So the whole purpose of nephron sparing surgery is gone. Now, this is what it meant. This is the excised parenchymal mass, EPM. This has been excised. Then you do renorrhaphy, and you see the amount of devascularized tissue in the renal parenchyma, fairly large. Now you see, use whatever this system devascularized parenchymal mass, what you're looking at. Here you see the coefficient, the p-value here, look at all the sort of variables here, and is found that the amount of tissue you leave behind is extremely important. So devascularized parenchymal mass during reconstruction is more substantial than excised parenchymal mass. It is associated strongly with the functional decline after partial nephrectomy. So devascularization parenchymal mass was less prominent in many cases, and it's important that you leave this parenchyma as healthy as possible. And this is how, again, how we calculate the devascularized mass. One paper came in BJUI. That's a beautiful picture here, what you see here. And what they use, the terminology, which is called as RAIV. This is resected and ischemic volume. This is a tumor. You resected margin. Then you see area of ischemic change during urinorrhaphy. You put it everything together. You have fair amount of tissue, which is ischemic. So that's why when you do a good repair, that's what I mean. I think technique is important. Either you do open or laparoscopy, robotic. Do not damage nephrons with all your slide techniques and sliding and clips and everything there. And this is what I mean. And this is our mid-polar tumor. Maybe in this kind of situation, I don't want to sort of do a compression, damage more nephrons. Maybe you can leave it open here, as you see. Mid-polar tumor, I done a partial nephrectomy, repair the PC system, under and the parenchyma, do not close it. Just leave it like that, and you can save more and more nephrons. And this is how I showed you just a case before. Just leave it like open, and this is what it is. And also important is do not violate the oncological principles and negative margins and no spillage here. Now, this was one case where patient had a big tumor in the renal parenchyma, did an intraoperative ultrasound, which was not possible. We have a tactile feel during the open surgery, and patient had to have a radical nephrectomy. Complication-wise, I think who does best is more important. If you have skilled laparoscopic robotic surgery, good margins, good time, leave good parenchyma, good repair, all go for it. And these numbers actually does not matter. You do laparoscopy open. These are the figures on standard studies or meta-analysis, but do what you can do best. Now, it is always sort of feeling that whatever new comes, you keep on swaying on that side. Don't do that. You know, have your sort of basic ideas. What is important is cancer cure as well as saving the good nephrons. Coming to the last part, you know, the complications of nephron sparing surgery. Intraoperative, you can get bleeding, longer ischemia time. What is important is pre-op planning, meticulous dissection, PC system closure, surgical skills, and use newer technologies. And if at all you get positive margins on a frozen section, then perhaps you need to revise the margins and do more extensive or maybe convert into a radical nephrectomy. The immediate post-op, you can get ATN, urinary leak, bleeding. You need to have backup of dialysis. You may need endourological support, may require open repair, maybe you require embolization. Late renal insufficiency, if you have left very small renal parenchyma left there, because nowadays I've seen a lot of patients, you know, with 7, 8 centimeter, 10 centimeter, people trying to do nephron sparing surgery. Yes, you can do that, but how much is sort of good parenchyma you're going to leave behind is important. And we talk about local recurrence shortly. And these are the complications based on various studies, about 8 to 10%, which you all know. Now, if you get a bleeding and a longer ischemia time, I think is important. You have good vascular control, suture with PDS, hemoloclips, use surgical gel foam, it can help. Urinary leak, it should stop by itself. You can use preoperative cannulation, use methylene glue, repair, JJ stents wherever is required. And if required, don't sit on it. You just do explore and repair it. Just hope that it will settle down. It actually can be more detrimental in these patients. What is important nowadays I've seen is delayed hemorrhage. And this guy who had a tumor in the sort of an anterior sort of wall of the kidney, we did a good nephron sparing surgery, good sort of, you know, parenchymal repair. He came after 6 weeks, and you see this guy presented with a huge bleeding and a huge clot in the ureter and a lot of clots in the bladder itself. And you can see cystoscopy, a lot of clots coming out here. RGP, whole ureter is associated, you know, full of all the clots. So we did a color Doppler. There is an AV fistula which is formed 6 weeks after the primary repair. So I had to go into angioembolization. The stent was also put in at the time when we evacuated all the clots, and the patient settled down post-embolization and the renal function has been very well maintained. If you have ATN, take the nephrologist's help. Progressive renal failure, you need to have eGFR before estimation and then follow them regularly. And it's very, very important. What about local recurrence? The safe margin, what we talked about is 0.2 centimeter, which is acceptable. Anything less than that, I think you should be very skeptical about. Now, lately, I am seeing a lot of patients which are having polar tumors, which we define as TA. And subsequently, the final histology does suggest that there is invasion of the perinephric fat of these polar tumors. So what you thought or stage is clinically T1A, less than 4 centimeter exophytic tumors. If the final histology shows perinephric fat invasion, they would be staged as PT3A. So we should be thinking whether we should be really doing partial nephrectomy in these kind of patients. Now, sometimes cystic lesions, they can rupture. This is a cystic lesion. Now, this guy had a laparoscopy done somewhere outside. Patient bled, clamped, declamped, and again, he came back in 3 months with a local recurrence as such. And the complications, what are the factors? Size, lap versus open, surgical skills, larger tumor, more invasive procedure, minimally invasive procedures for a bigger tumors, you can ask for complications. So this is actually protocol, how you follow these patients. And I think you divide them into low risk, intermediate risk, and high risk. And if it is sort of a high, if it is a final microscopic, the surgical margins are positive for a cancer, then these patients should be sort of closely monitored very, very importantly. And this is how the AUA guidelines tell you how frequently you do the imaging itself. Now, at the end, I think we have another 15 minutes to 20 minutes. And I'm going to show you some cases. And then I'm ready for interaction. Now, this is the lady which came actually with a tumor in the left kidney, the upper pole. You can see the kidneys, right kidney is fine. There is a big tumor. And looking at this, I thought she may have something like an cystic lesion or a hydatid disease. And this is a tumor which is sitting in the upper pole of the left kidney. So this is a schematic diagram, as I told you. I actually draw on my operation sheet as well, draw Kiva, Aorta, whatever it is. Schematically diagram 3D pictures and plan my surgery itself. So I did a partial on this. All the margins were clear. And you can see I have looped the vessel here. I've used hypothermia, fairly big tumor. left all the perinephric fat here, did a partial nephrectomy on this. And you see it's a good margin. It's a very good margin here. Nephron sparing surgery has been done. And this is what I meant, the renorapy. I do early declamping. So once the tumor has been out, I do PC system repair. And I use something like 40 PDS just to approximate the parenchyma. Before that, I would have done a continuous suture here. So I done early declamping. And it was mainly Serafina nephron sparing surgery done. Now, this is possible even in a bigger tumor. This ultimately turned out to be mixed epithelial stromal tumor. It's quite interesting in that lady. This is a 45-year-old guy who had a vent encapsulated lesion of a 4 cm. Looking at this, people would say half is endophytic, half is exophytic, maybe midpolar. Can we do something about it? And he was very keen that he needed a partial nephrectomy. He was very keen. Look at 3D sort of, you know, images. Here it looks mainly involving the upper portion of the sort of kidney, mainly endophytic. And when I went inside, believe me, when I did intraoperative ultrasound, I knew for sure there was actually nearness to the PC system and I won't be able to get a positive margin. So I had counseled him before. So we talked about preoperative imaging. You look at 3D, you prepare these patients for a possibility of radical nephrectomy when you use intraoperative ultrasound. So I used intraoperative ultrasound. I knew I won't be able to get sort of margins clear here, and proof is the pudding is here. I did a radical here. You can see it's a multifocal disease. Now, I don't think you will be able to get sort of clear margins here. You're actually in the renal sinus itself. So even repair would have been slightly difficult, very difficult. So it's very easy to make a decision on table when you had decided to do a radical nephrectomy. And this is how it shows. And I would have burned my fingers. Patient would have certainly come with a local relapse. So this is the importance of preoperative planning, intraoperative ultrasound, and preoperative counseling for a radical nephrectomy. Now, this guy has a right lower polar renal mass. Right lower polar renal mass. Actually, I went inside, clamped, pulled the kidney, took it out. Good margins. I was a bit sort of doubtful whether I got right up to the base itself. And the pathologist, the frozen section, was not available that particular day. You know, and he was pretty new. He didn't know where is the apex, where is the base. I didn't want to lose my time for sort of waiting for a frozen section. I just bivalved the specimen. And you see beautifully seen specimen here. You see sort of good here. And this is much more easier to repair. Now this has been repaired as such, very nicely done. Now this is how repair has been very nicely done. Now post of 3 years, this guy, you see beautiful CT scan. It's a beautiful CT scan. And almost good perfusion, renal function has been maintained as such. Patient was very keen for NSS. Patient has diabetes and blood pressure. You see, this is a tumor here. This is a tumor here. When I went inside, I'll take you back to the previous CT scan. Here, somebody may say it is possible. You know, you just clean it out. It may be possible. I was pretty sure it's not. He's diabetic, he's hypertensive. And intraoperative ultrasound, you see the entire tumor was studied with the tumor itself. Entire tumor. So what appears on a CT scan, it may not replicate on the table. Central tumor, no question of nephron sparing surgery. Now this guy, another guy which I'm talking about, he had sort of a left renal calculopathy, had an ESWL, he had a left-sided loin pain, and he had a 4 mm left renal calculi and incidentally found 4 cm mass in the right kidney, and his wife was a pathologist here with us. You see, this is the tumor here. I thought it's a midpole, exophytic, midpole exophytic, and he himself was keen for a partial nephrectomy. He himself was keen, the opposite kidney looked okay. And I thought, this is something challenging. When I go inside, you know, I may not be able to get a proper margin. You know, this is how I thought I may not be able to get a proper margin. And I had counseled him that this patient may require radical nephrectomy. This is how the picture is. And as I said to you, I went inside, tried to repair everything. Good repair done. I sent it for a frozen section. The pathologist said the margins are positive. It is a single line, single layer, how many millimeters? And they were not entirely sure. And she herself was a pathologist. I actually went inside, take further biopsies. They all turned out to be positive. And I had to go back and do a radical nephrectomy. Yes, down the line, this is free. But sometimes these challenges crop up and just don't make an ego. Yes, you have done it. It doesn't matter. You're in single cell line, close it and see what happens. You can always come back and do a radical nephrectomy. I don't think that should be the case. Now, this guy presented with irritable bowel syndrome. He had incidentally found left renal mass. And this was mainly the lower polar mass. You see, this is a lower polar mass. Lower polar mass. This is how it looks like. I thought it's much more going to be easy, cake. Went inside. I thought it's exophytic, but a lot of tumor was endophytic here. So I actually bare it open, took the gerontospatia there, clamped the vessel, pulled the kidney, and then eventually, when I use intraoperative ultrasound, then and then I was able to get this tumor out. And you see, slowly I'm peeling it out, and then sort of, you know, and do the PCA system repair. And though I was not able to show a video clip, which I'll try at the end of my talk, but this is how I do. This is how, once it's bare open, it's all been clamped, pull the kidney, use 50 PDS to repair the PCA system and small feeding vessels. Then use the same 50 PDS to run through continuously through all along the entire margin here, continuously all around here. So there is not so much bleeding, and then it's much more easier to do a final repair. Sometimes you can just keep it open. Sometimes you repair in oblong fashion. And this is how it was done. Early declamping, good perfusion, and the kidney has been saved. And you see, this is what it looks like. Now, lately, what is actually hounding me is sometimes you get a multifocal renal cell carcinoma. Yes, I got sort of good margins, agree. But if it is a multifocal, have I done the right thing? Whether it's aggressive, whether it will relapse, whether it will come back, that is something hiding me lately as such. Now, this is how it looks like, you know, a multifocal tumor, very aggressive. And I don't think this was all picked up on CT scan. It just looked like a single mass on a CT. And when I looked at sort of intraoperatively, I could actually feel multifocal lesions and multicentric lesions, not worth larger lesions, not worth doing sort of a partial nephrectomy, even in a solitary kidney. Look at this patient. Patient was treated for a CAOV in the past and then came down with this kind of mass here, this kind of mass. She had radiation, sorry, CA cervix radiation in the past. And this was a mass here. This was a mass. Actually went inside, cooled the kidney. She was treated for CA cervix many, many years ago. So did a nephron sparing surgery. Frozen sections, margins clear. This was told to us is an oncocytoma. I was quite happy. Second malignancy, a lady who just survived renal sort of CA cervix. And recurrent camera repair was done. Post op recovery, the final histology turned out to be translocation XP11.2. So sometimes the pathologist on the frozen can also make sort of a mistake itself. Luckily, in adults, translocation, you know, sometimes can be aggressive, but luckily in this case, patient has been doing very well. So maybe when you do a biopsy preoperatively, you may be fooled that you may have sort of look like a benign histopathology, but final histopathology may be entirely different. Now, this is another case, which is 58-year-old guy who's smoker, alcohol, diabetic. He had a left partial Stagon calculus, and somebody had done sort of, you know, surgery. He bled, he had his left nephrectomy. Actually, he was a policeman. And he came down with hematuria, creatinine of 1.8, ischemic heart disease, poor ejection fraction. And he had a mass lesion like this. You see, this is a big mass in a solitary kidney. And this was mainly the upper pole. You can see the feeding vessel here. And I was pretty sure that we will be able to do either a heminephrectomy in this guy because he has a solitary kidney. He had lost his left kidney because of intraoperative bleeding during stone surgery 15 years ago. And he is a policeman. Doesn't that it would sort of make any sort of a point in counseling? But I thought by angio pictures, everything, I can actually clip this and do a wedge or sort of heminephrectomy on this. On CT, this picture was there. And I thought it may be because he had hematuria, he must have had a clot in the PCA system. Anyway, I said, we'll go inside, see what happens and try and sort of pick it up. So I go inside, pull the kidney. This is the upper pole, head end of the patient, foot end of the patient. And you can see this is a tumor thrombus, which is actually going into the PCA system. Tumor thrombus going into the PCA system. So this is how I did a heminephrectomy here. So I opened the calyx. Took out all that tumor thrombus. You can see the tumor thrombus here. And this is our repair. The PCA system with 40 PDS, kidney is still cool. And this is important, you know, when you repair, don't try and peel off as much sort of a gerontospatia here in the remaining parenchyma. You can do it on the tumor if you want to. Because once you peel off too much of a capsule, the repair becomes difficult in diabetic patients, hypertensive patients, elderly patients. So try and preserve the capsule as well as the sort of, you know, gerontospatia here. So I ran through everything and do a good closure, you know, declamp, perfusion is fine, wonderful. 20 minutes, early declamping, 150 cc blood loss. He's almost sort of post-op 3.5 years. This is free, creatinine 1.9, stable. So what it looks like, a tumor thrombus, not invading the PCA system, still you can repair it very well, especially in a solitary kidney, but you have to take a call properly. Now, this is almost, 3.5 years solitary right kidney with no evidence of recurrence. So in conclusion, with nephron-sparing surgery, pre-op accurate assessment and planning is must if you are aiming for nephron-sparing surgery. It has a good cancer outcome. Safety first, no clamping, hypothermia. I think use which is safer for the patient. Meticulous dissection and repair is the key to success. I did not mention here, but it's very important. It's not only the ischemia time, but whatever remaining parenchyma left, I think is important. So use your technique very, very judiciously. I've seen people using something like 2-0 Vicryl or a big Vicryl and just running through and just sort of, repairing the renal parenchyma. You can imagine the amount of nephron damage you do in these patients. And apart from that, the artifact, what you leave inside. Overall complication rate with open nephron sparing surgery is around 10%. With lab is around 25 to 30% in good old series, but now I think it has gone much, much less as such. And it should be performed minimally invasive surgery with an expert hands. It is not sort of piece of cake for each and everyone. Thank you very much. I think I finished my presentation. I'm sorry about 3 to 4 minutes delay because of some problem in connecting to you. And I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much for patient hearing and thank you for opportunity. I hope I didn't make it very, very complicated and labored talk for all of you. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I think, sir, this is Dr. Keshav. We can ask the residents to take the quiz.
Yeah. I think it's open.
Yeah, so the quiz is open and in between we'll take the questions which have come in the chat box. Dr. Makkand, it's okay if I put you the questions from the chat box?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, there's a question from Dr. Lakshman Prabhu. Can you explain the phenomena of treatment disconnect, distant failure after well-done nephron sparing surgery?
It all depends on biological behavior. What you have done is what is appropriate for that cancer. Partial nephrectomy versus radical nephrectomy doesn't give you sort of a leverage or doesn't immunity towards sort of a distant failure as such. If the biological behavior is bad, it's like if you get somebody who has very aggressive type of, type sort of a tooth papillary renal cell carcinoma. You get something in a very aggressive type of renal cell carcinoma, some sort of clear cell renal cell carcinomas. The biological behavior itself is such that they may fail distantly. And if we all know that renal cell carcinoma can metastasize, 5 years, 10 years down the line. So it has nothing to do with the surgery itself. If you get a local recurrence, I can understand. But if you get a distant failure, it's something to do with the biology.
Okay. Another question is on the Rhino-Refi. Your opinion about the barbed sutures?
Yes. I mean, I think I showed you the pictures, how the repair has been done. I try to be as meticulous and try and use something fine, long-lasting sutures like 4-0 and 5-0 PDS. I personally do not use bar, but I'm sure it's everybody's choice as long as you're able to do a good meticulous job and leave a good renal parenchyma behind without ischemic damage, that's okay with me.
Another question is how much change in GFR happens after partial nephrectomy on an average for a polar tumor?
For a polar tumor, I don't think it should be more. It should be more than 10. It should not be more than 10.
This question from resident, is there any role of mannitol or Lasix prior to clamping the vessels in nephron sparing surgery?
Good question. As I mentioned to you, Indy Gill, when he developed his all different techniques of doing laparoscopic surgery, I mentioned a while ago, as early as something like 2004, 2005, he used to give sort of hypotensive anesthesia, get the blood pressure on the lower side. And to avoid an ATN, he used to give them mannitol or Lasix and then post-operatively perfuse them again. But in general, I think he has also given up on that. I talked to him recently and many centers also do not do that. So I don't think it has any role so far. And none of the guidelines mention that you have to use this mannitol or Lasix or diuretics to avoid any renal perfusion injury.
Okay. Another question is on intraoperative frozen section. So if you have laparoscopy or robotics versus open, the indications of frozen section, and if you are doing it and when you are waiting for frozen section report, what do you do?
Actually, I start.
You finish a Rhino-Refi and wait, or what do you do?
I think technically, as I showed you in a few of my slides and pictures also, the moment specimen comes out, my pathologist is actually sitting or coming in, he is actually part of my team during the nephron splitting surgery. So in his presence, because our frozen section is very next door into the theater complex itself, once the specimen comes out, in front of me, I orient him what is the base, what is the apex, and actually bivalve in front of him only. So if I see a good margin there parenchymal, I really don't want to have a frozen section. I just go and repair it. But if it is something that I really want to know, then they take it back. But I don't stop at that particular point. I keep on repairing. If it turns out to be, at least the PC system is repaired. I don't close the parenchyma. So by the time they give me the reports, you know, then I would have done the early declamping. And then maybe I take sort of a further sort of a deeper margins. But that incidence has hardly occurred in my life, except the one case I showed you, the mid big polar tumor encroaching the renal sinus. Apart from that, and the most of the times you are okay.
Look, this is a question from Dr. Kaushal. The cutoff GFR for deciding the nephron sparing and the artery clamping versus both artery and vein clamping.
I really do not get into really sort of, you know, what should be cut off for my GFR. If somebody who has got a CKD, maybe CKD 2, CKD 3, I want to do minimal damage to his kidney in terms of, you know, ischemia, vasculature, perfusion, as well as the remaining parenchyma. So here I would try and do something like a clampless, you know, as much as I can. And then what I do is only selectively at the time when I'm going to excise the tumor, maybe I selectively will clamp this vessel. And a super selective dissection is also possible if you can. And then, you know, just take it out rather than doing sort of an entire clamping. So I don't keep any, you know, cutoff as such. Either you do selective sort of, you know, renal sort of, you know, clamping of that particular branch, or try and just minimize it. But I don't set off any sort of, you know, cutoff for an EGFR. Here I would not use clamp, here I would use a clamp.
This is another interesting question. We see the recovery of shattered kidney during conservative management of renal trauma. And why not extend it this principle to nephron sparing surgery?
I think basically what happens is, if you see the difference between the trauma, the shattered kidney, and surgery, which has been sort of traumatized during surgery itself. Here it what happens, the injury is mainly in the parenchyma. The renal perfusion is still going on. What happens is a huge tamponade, which actually stops further bleeding and actually giving rest to the rest of the parenchyma. At not a single point, if there is no vascular thrombus, no intimal injury, no renal vein thrombosis, the perfusion to the rest of the kidney is very well maintained. So what is actually helping to holding the kidney together is basically a tamponade, right? And eventually, as the clot and everything, the hematoma dissolves, it heals by scarring or sort of, you know, fibrosis. But remember, during all that, the renal perfusion is very well maintained. So what we do in conservative management, we make sure the renal perfusion is good. We keep on looking at color Doppler ultrasound. There is no thrombus in the artery and vein. So perfusion is never been compromised in this situation, unless this patient has multi-organ injuries. Patient had landed into head injury, lung injuries, hypotension. These patients, even on conservative management, do have sort of a renal perfusion injury. They can have it because of hypotension. But blood pressure is maintained. Tamponade, I don't think they will have any problem in terms of outcome.
Okay. Now, another question which I'll ask, if we have a patient with renal failure, the GFR is low, what would be the choice of investigation for a small renal mass? The ultrasound, the weather Doppler, plain CT, the MRI, or contrast-based imaging with later dialysis?
I think it's important. No contrast-based imaging with later on dialysis. I won't do that. Basically, what you want to do in a small renal mass, whether it is something needs a treatment, whether it is an aggressive potential, so do an ultrasound with color Doppler, that's fine. CT plane is okay. And just augment with sort of an MRI. No contrast. And here, if you feel that this patient has something like, you know, small renal mass, doesn't look like something like an aggressive, you know, on this imaging, then perhaps just stick a needle into it, confirm the diagnosis and observe. But if you feel it's something like an aggressive histology, then perhaps either you can use something like a thermal ablation or do a partial nephrectomy. Obviously, in the long run, this guy is going to get into CKD, but certainly not compromising, you know, giving a contrast and then use for dialysis. Ultrasound, augment with plain CT and an MRI. No further investigations. just do a biopsy and take it further.
Is there any controversy regarding the size for the small renal mass, 3 centimeter versus 4 centimeter?
I think previously people used to use 3 centimeter as a cutoff, but in the first slide in my first talk, as I showed to you, why people are now saying is 4 centimeter, because over the period of time, accumulated data suggests that if the tumor is less than 4 centimeter size, not less than 3 centimeter size, 4 centimeter size, then 20% chance that it's going to be benign. Only 20% have aggressive histology, and majority, more than 80 to 90% of the patients do not metastasize or have local recurrence. So they have a low grade disease and low stage disease. So that's why 4 centimeter is been sort of now considered as a gold standard for a small renal mass. If you look at the TNM classification, CT1A is less than 4 centimeter, which is called as a small renal mass. Having said that, any tumor which is beyond that should not be considered as a small renal mass and should not be contemplated for partial nephrectomy. No. If you have a big exophytic tumor, 80%, which is outside into the gyrodes fascia, only 20% of renal parenchyma, maybe 7 centimeter, you still can do a partial exophytic tumors. So size per se, in general, says less than 4 centimeters of small renal mass, but you can extend your indication for a partial nephrectomy depending on the location and biological behavior. Having said that, there are some people who are hell-bound on doing partial in each and every case, looking at their experience, expertise, and imaging itself. So my answer to those people is, if you have a hammer, you know, you don't sort of keep on sort of nailing each and everything. So don't do that. Don't do that.
So this SRM is T1A renal tumor. That's we need to believe.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
I think so.
Now, the question from the chat box, which was there, your opinion about renal artery clamping only versus renal artery and vein clamping?
I think renal artery clamping is much better, much better. Mm-hmm. Anyway, you are dissecting the renal hilum. You take a few minutes to go find out the artery and vein. And mind you, many times I've been fooled, you know, is sometimes you feel it's only sort of single artery, and on exploration, you found another sort of lower pole artery directly coming from the aorta going to the lower pole itself. And so it's important, you know, you dissect it out. I usually do not like to do a complete cross clamping. Anyway, you're done dissection of the hilum, so use only artery. Allow the perfusion to get to the vein itself.
So like your know your opinion about trifecta outcomes on NSS with the warm ischemia or cold ischemia, open versus minimal visit technique, your experience.
I think whosoever has asked the question perhaps missed the major part of my talk. I think the half of the talk was basically on the entire sort of, you know, history, how the warm ischemia, cold ischemia, clamp, non-clamp. So I think just to put it in a very short, short manner, I think you need to do a good job. I prefer to do a sort of a hypothermia for complex renal masses where it requires a good PC system and a renography itself. And I know I'm going to take a bit of longer time, bigger tumors. So my cutoff in these patients is use hypothermia. It's always safe. Identify the vessels, clamp the artery, pull the kidney, take as much as your time and do a good job. But if it is something like a very small tumor, an exophytic tumor, polar tumor, then perhaps, you know, maybe without clamp or with clamp, you just excise it. And again, try and minimize the duration itself. So if you do this, then the trifecta comes in handy. I mean, you're going to get a good outcome, cancer cure, clear margins, and good renal function recovery. That's a trifecta. So that is what the answer is.
Okay. You did talk about the parenchymal suturing and in minimal invasive techniques, we find there's only sometimes only inner renography being performed and the outer parenchyma is left on stage. Do you think this can be the similar technique can be extrapolated to the open techniques also?
I mean, I would put it other way around.
Just to preserve the parenchyma, because we are, this is a something like where we preserve the nephrons by not suturing it.
Yeah, so I showed you in a couple of cases where it was a mid-polar lesion. You know, you can't sort of do an oblong repair. So you just go inside, do the PC system repair, run through the parenchyma only along with the capsule itself, and you can leave the defect. And I showed you one of the post-op CT scan where you can see that defect there, eventually it collapses. A lot of people just put an omentum there. A lot of people just put something like surgicel but do not do sort of, you know, compression, sort of, you know, parenchymal primary repair. So that's also possible. It depends on, you know, whether you've done the clean job or not.
Okay. If you are doing nephrons sparing surgery, supposing you encounter during the clamping time, you find a small node around the hilum, which was probably not taken note of during the CT scan. So what will be your plan? Nephron sparing continue and lymph node sampling, or you convert to radical and lymph node dissection?
Very, very important question. What is important is basically you want to make sure you have done a clean cut job with the safe margins itself. Now, there is a lot of, you know, there are a lot of studies which have come doing a partial nephrectomy even in a metastatic setting. So if somebody who has a contralateral normal kidney, he has sort of, you know, only his 4 centimeter lower polar tumor and has a lung metastasis, radical nephrectomy, or you do a partial nephrectomy. So I would answer your question just like that. Suppose you would not have found a lymph node there, then I don't know whether this lymph node is really positive, because we have done many high-risk patients lymph node dissection, which on CT preoperatively felt that they may be lymph node metastasis. We've done sampling, and more than 8 out of 10 times, all the lymph nodes turn out to be negative as such. They're more of a reactionary, more of sort of inflammatory lymph nodes as such. So if it is only single node, which you feel suspicious, it won't stop me from doing a partial nephrectomy. I would do a partial, do a lymph node, same sampling, frozen section. Maybe he would require sort of a good lymph node clearance on that side, but would not convert this into a radical nephrectomy.
How do you find the pseudocapsule in nephron sparing? Is it well developed in all the endophytic tumors, or you have correlated with the biopsy of the renal masses? Is it uniformly present, or it is uniform phenomena of having a pseudocapsule?
I think in most of the tumors it is there. I think the smaller the tumor, you'll be able to appreciate it much better. But if the tumor grows much more towards the PC system, nearness to the PC system, renal sinus, the line towards the pseudocapsule is usually sort of bizarre. And it gets thinned out. So you will get it something like in a full circle. You will get something like a 3/4. But towards the base, you may not be able to get it. You may not be able to appreciate. And that is how the crux of situation. When you do enucleation, you know, patients who do something like conical sort of, you know, excision, wedge excision, you know what happens? Enucleation or wedge excision. The pathologist said, I'm okay with the peripheral margins, but I don't know what is the base. And that is important for you.
There is a question from the chat box.
I think it's close.
The last question from the chat box, sir. Last question. If you have a cystic tumor, which is breached, the wall is breached and you have spillover, how you're going to manage it?
It depends on what kind of tumor patient has. If the patient has something like Bosniak 3, meaning it's entirely something more of a cystic, and only a few area you are a bit suspicious about, then perhaps I may be okay. You take sort of wider margin, you'd have taken a good renal parenchyma all around and prepare it, that's okay. But if it is something like Bosniak 4 with a solid component, I'll be really worried about patient having leukal recurrence. On a case I showed you in my presentation, we thought it's a sort of bigger tumor. He had come to me, I had offered him open partial nephrectomy. He was keen that he gets a laparoscopy in very old days as such. And then he had intraoperative spillage. And you see the result in about 3 months, he had a large local recurrence and he died of metastasis. Mm-hmm. So it depends on the size, complexity, associated solid component in that. That is very important. If you're in doubt, just go and do a complete clearance and you clean it up completely.
And you agree to prevent this, you keep the perinephric fat over the cystic tumor preserved and you don't have it very roughly.
Yeah, especially on this on its surface, you know, yeah. on its sort of dome. You need something in the periphery. But again, don't try and peel off fat around too much of a renal parenchyma, because if you peel it off too much, then the repair of the rest of the parenchyma is also technically difficult. Yeah. And you need that perinephric fat. You need that perinephric fat on the tumor, because I said to you, what turned out to be CTA T1A ultimately may turn out to be, you know, PT3, you know, invasive perinephric fat.
I think that's all from my end, and we are going above our time limits. And with this, thank you very much for an excellent presentation. And over to you, Dr. Keshav, for closing remarks.
Thank you, Arun. Thank you, Dr. Makarand, for a comprehensive coverage of the small renal mass and the techniques It was a wonderfully covered topic. I think the residents would have enjoyed this session. It has covered almost all the points which were required for the residents to know about it. Thank you very much on behalf of the USI for your wonderful talk, Dr. Makarand. Now I hand over to Dr. Rajiv Sood for his closing remarks. Over to you, Dr. Rajiv.
Thank you, Dr. Keshav. The important topic has been covered wonderfully by Dr. Makarand, and this is what is always expected from him. And I think residents are hugely benefited with this program. And in this distant learning program for residents, this is going to be a very good archived lecture, and where each and every intricacy of nephron sparing surgery has been discussed, and it was quite interactive. I'm thankful to everybody, and let us remain tuned for our programs of Indian School of Urology and distinct learning. Thank you very much. Back to Dr. Keshav.
Thank you, Dr. Makarand. Let me tell you that there were a lot of consultants actually who had logged in.
Yes, yes.
Not only the residents, there were a lot of yes, consultants sir. Who had logged in and were keen to hear to your lecture. Thank you very much for your wonderful talk.
Thank you, Dr. Makarand. Thank you, Dr. Keshav. Thank you, Dr. Rajiv. Thanks, all of you. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, Makarand. Yeah, Makarand.
Yes,
yeah,
thank you. Yeah, please.
Yeah, I think the feedback, I think I would like love to have a feedback, because every time I do a talk, I kick myself and say I could have done better. See, if you get the feedback from all the audience and trainees and the consultants and all the, you know, staff of the ISU, USI.
Yeah, Arun will certainly do that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you, Kesha.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir. Good night,
thank
sir.
Thank you very much.
Good night.